بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, our creator, the creator of this universe and of everything that's in it, the sole supreme being in control of this world and the world to come, I greet you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, mercy and blessings be with you all. This program is entitled Reason. And reason is logic, rationality, intelligence, thinking properly. And we try to reason in this program the superiority of Islam and the superiority of the Quran above all books. This superiority stems from the fact that the Holy Quran is the only form of divine guidance within the hands of man today that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of Allah in its entirety, word to word and letter to letter. Inasmuch as religion cannot be man-made, so man needs a divine guidance in the area of religion, a divine guidance that is purely divine without the slightest human infiltration. Islam has been always described as the fastest growing religion in the world, simply because it talks reasonably, rationally, intelligently. It respects the human intellect and talks to it in a proper language. In Islam, we are asked to believe in one God without parallels, partners, or similitudes, without wives or children, without rivals. We are asked to believe in the unity of the message revealed to man, the equality of all prophets and messengers of God. We believe in the unity of the human race. You are all to Adam, and Adam is from earth, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, and this makes logic to everybody. Because of this, in 1991, when the American troops invaded the Arabian Gulf region with their military might, they went back with more than 20,000 embracing Islam, between men and women, blacks and whites, major generals and ordinary soldiers. Islam has never been talked to any logical person in a language that can be understood, and he refused it. Because of this, we are reasoning with you tonight the rationality of the Holy Quran. This rationality of the Holy Quran stems from the fact that every single word in it is absolutely correct, whether this is in the domain of the message itself, with its four basic foundations, faith, acts of worship, the moral code, and the code of transactions with others, or in the narration of previous civilizations, previous nations, how did they react to the divine message? What was the reward or punishment? Whether it talks about prophecies in the future that came true, whether it addresses scientific subjects, parts of that cosmos and its phenomena, the Quran is always truthful. Tonight we will speak about five verses that come in Surah Ar-Rum, the Romans, chapter number 30, the Holy Quran. These five verses comes at the very beginning of the surah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alif Lam Mim, غلبت الروم في أذن الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين. لله الأمر من قبل ومن بعد ويومئذ يفرح المؤمنون بنصر الله ينصر من يشاء وهو العزيز الرحيم. ألف لام ميم. These abbreviations are part of the secret of the Holy Quran. These abbreviated letters ألف لام ميم, nobody could explain fully up till now, so I'll leave it aside. The Romans have been defeated in a land close by, or the lowest part of the globe, but they, even after this defeat of theirs, will soon be victorious within a few years. With Allah is the command in the past and in the future. On that day shall the believers rejoice. With the help of Allah, He gives victory to whom He wills, and He is exalted in might, most merciful. So in this verse, there is a prophecy of something that did not happen at the time of revelation of the Holy Quran, and it came true within a few years. It also contains a basic scientific fact that addresses the area where the battle did take place and is described as the lowest part of the terrestrial area on the surface of that planet. Before I indulge in commenting on this verse, I would like to ask our colleagues and friends here what reflection they may get from reading these five verses. Alif Lam Mim, غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين. Neil, could you tell us?
Thank you, Doc. As you mentioned, this verse has both scientific miracles and it has a prophecy of something that would happen in the following years to the revelation of that verse.
Yes.
And what caught my attention was the idea of having prophecies in the Quran. The Quran contains several prophecies. This is just one of them.
Yes.
So if only one of these prophecies did not come true, then that would have been the end of Islam forever.
Yes.
So this is one of the reasons why we believe and we are 100% sure that the Quran can only be the word of Allah, because He knows the future and He knows the past. Yes. And every single one of these prophecies came true. Another point, which is in the past, the disbelievers used to claim that the Prophet Muhammad والسلام, was the one who wrote the Quran himself, and it wasn't actually divine.
Yes.
So if this was the case, why would he risk and talk about prophecies?
Yes.
And the same, if one of these never came true, then everybody would have truly disbelieved Islam and his message.
Barakallahu feek. Susie, would you tell us your reflections about these verses?
Yes, I won't go inside the interpretation of the verse, but rather I will say a little story about concerning this verse. When this verse came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of his friends or closest Abu Bakr, his closest friend, he believed in all what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. He went out and told to all the disbelievers about this verse that the Romans will be victorious and they will be they will win the Persians. So one of the disbelievers told him, "Okay, I will bet you that this will happen." And they he told him this will be in 9 years, from 3 to 9 years. And here comes the accuracy of the Quran, that fi bid'a sanin. Bid'a sanin means in few years.
Yes.
And in Arabic means from 3 till 9.
Yes.
And after 7 years, the Romans were victorious on the Persians, and Abu Bakr won the battle. What I want to say in this, or what I want to conclude, is although it was that time unlogical for the Romans to be victorious, but because it came from Allah, it was very, Abu Bakr was very sure that it will happen, and it happened.
Barakallahu feek. And Lina?
I would like to say that almost anyone could narrate the past, like whether he was an eyewitness or even heard about it. But it's totally impossible for someone to predict the future and what will happen. So what about the unlettered Prophet, peace be upon him, when he said that? How could he know something like that happening in the future when he's just a human being also?
Yes.
This is just an assurance that this was sent from God, and this gives greater credibility and superiority for the Holy Quran.
Barakallahu feek. When we read this verse, we remember the event that at the time of the revelation of the Holy Quran, the two world powers were the Romans and the Persians. The Romans were Christians, people of the book, and the Persians were heathens, worshippers of fire. And that's why the unbelievers in Arabia took the side of the Persians. The Persians invaded the Roman Empire and defeated them in a humiliating defeat. This was around the year 615 in the Christian era. And this was the date when Jerusalem was captured by the Persians. They destroyed it and they almost kicked out the Romans from the region completely. And at that time, the unbelievers in Arabia rejoiced because they were telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his followers that here is a case where people who claim to be following the divine guidance, people of the book, like the Romans, they were bitterly defeated at the hands of heathens and idol worshippers like the Persians. Why do you come and tell us about another revelation and believing in the unseen and believing in the divine being? So Abu Bakr, one of the closest companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam complaining about the rejoicing of the kafirs, of the unbelievers. So the Prophet told him immediately, rest assured that the Romans will defeat the Persians. And these verses came down. غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين. And as Susie correctly said, بضع in Arabic means a span of time, no less than 3 years and no more than 9 years. So Abu Bakr told the Kafirs that the Romans will definitely achieve victory. And they just laughed because nobody could dream of this. They were really defeated in a very humiliating defeat. And nobody at the time could ever think about the possibility of the Romans can stand on their feet again and come to face the Persians. So they made a challenge. Abu Bakr told them within about 5 years they will achieve their victory. The 5 years passed without the Romans achieving victory. So he went back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet asked him, Abu Bakr, what does the word bid'ah mean in Arabic? He said between 3 and 9. He said, why didn't you make it 7 or 9 years? And within 7 years exactly, the battle started and the Persians were defeated and humiliated. Most of their lands were invaded by the Romans and the Romans achieved their victory. This prophecy, as Neil correctly said, nobody could dare to speak about it, particularly cases of war between world powers like the Romans and the Persians. Nobody could foretell the future, what will happen. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say this, and for the Quran to come down emphasizing this, is an evidence that this cannot be the work of man. It is a divine revelation from Allah, who knows the past, the present, and the future. Because Allah, who has created the time does not limit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows everything in the past, in the present, and in the future. So this is one of the many prophecies of the Holy Quran that came true in the lifetime of Muhammad, peace be upon him. The other point is that the word adna al-ard, adna in Arabic, can mean the nearest or the lowest. So at that time, the commentator on the Holy Quran said it's the nearest. Adna al-ard means the nearest land to Arabia. And actually, Palestine is one of the nearest parts of Arabia. It is part and parcel of the whole Arabian Peninsula at large, which extends from the southern shores of Arabia up until the southern borders of Turkey. So Adna al-Ard meant the nearest, to the commentators, the nearest land to Arabia. And this was true. But strangely enough, we came to realize after the geological investigation of that region that the Dead Sea Valley, where the battle actually, the decisive battle between the Romans and the Persians did take place, was in the Dead Sea Basin. The Dead Sea Graben is a highly depressed area, an area limited by two folds, and the land in between has gone down, has dropped down for more than 800 meters. The sea level of the, or the level of the sea of water in the Dead Sea is at a level of 400 meters below the level of the sea in the Mediterranean or in the Red Sea. The bottom of the Dead Sea at its deepest part is almost another 400 meters. So it has been proved beyond any doubt that the lowest part on the surface of the terrestrial part of the globe is the Dead Sea Rift. This is a fact that was known to us or discovered only when the area has been geologically surveyed, when the Dead Sea was mapped properly in the 20th century, around the middle of the 20th century. And nobody knew this at the time of revelation of the Holy Quran. Nobody knew it at all. Not only this, but even today, If I ask some of the leading geologists of the world, where is the deepest part on the surface of the continental mass? He would tell me, for example, the Fayum region in Egypt, or Wadi al-Rayyan in Egypt, or the Death Valley in California. They don't even know it, and I have actually asked them. So how could an unlettered prophet like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, living in Arabia 14 centuries ago, would define that area as the lowest part of the land unless he was connected or guided by the divine knowledge through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this verse contains both prophecies that came true, and it contains a scientific fact that was not known to man until the middle part of the 20th century. And this alone can be a living testimony for the divine purity of the Holy Quran and the correct prophethood and messengerhood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I would like to ask May to comment on what I have said and what the brothers and sisters have said before.
I'd like to comment about these verses in a grammatical way. As you have kindly explained, in the second and the third verses, غُلِبَتْ and غَلْبِهِمْ are in the past tense, while in the fourth verse, يَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ is in the present tense.
Yes.
The past tense is always used by historians, while يَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ, I think that they mean here not only the mu'minun at the time of the Persians' defeat and the Romans' victory, but also the mu'minun and the believers up till this date, and those yet to come, because they are not only happy because of the victory, but also that everything that has been revealed in the Quran has become true. And this means that everything that is said in the Quran is valid and is credible.
Barakallahu fiik. Barakallahu fiik. She raised a very good point. Wael?
Yeah, I would like to say that the Quran is so precise and so straight and so descriptive of everything. There's no extra word and no less word in any of its verses,
yes.
Even no extra character.
Yes.
I'd like to emphasize on the fact that this lowest part is the lowest part on the whole earth. I mean, why would the Prophet say that this is the lowest if he doesn't know?
Of course.
And why would he risk that it wouldn't be the lowest part? But
yes.
Because this is the lowest part,
yes.
Allah described it as the lowest part on the whole earth.
Yes.
The other thing is emphasizing what Neil said about the prophecy of Bid'i Sinin.
Yes.
I mean, if I'm making up a prophecy now, why would I take the risk of having it not happen in a few years?
Yes.
I mean, if I'll make a prophecy, like in 200 years,
yes,
something will happen. And if it doesn't happen, I'll be dead by that time.
Yes.
But I was so sure that this will happen, so yes. I said, in Bid'i Sinin, which means that this is a divine guidance from Allah.
Yes.
And it's absolutely correct.
Barakallahu feek. The point raised by my really brought to my memory something really very good. That the fact that يَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ, and she said يَفْرَح is in the future tense, is in the present tense, and the event is in the past tense, because actually the same day the Romans defeated the Persians in 622, this was the same day of the Battle of Badr, and the believers achieved a great victory on the unbelievers. And this was their very first victory. And of course, the believers rejoiced for these two facts. First of all, because they achieved victory on the unbelievers of Mecca and the people around it. And at the same time, people of the book achieved victory on heathens and idol worshippers. And as May said, the tense here is in the present, because it can cover both the event at the time, which took place, the Badr battle, as well as the victory of the Romans over the Persians, as well as any event that can come in the future. Because this is the type of the Quranic expressions. Time does not limit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because time is part of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah controls time, and time does not control Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a verb that comes in the present, or in the past, or in the future tense, it does not limit itself to that particular time, which limits man, but does not limit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever a victory is achieved by the believers on the unbelievers. The believers have to rejoice and have to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here again is an advice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the true believers that they should not feel depressed because of at a certain time the unbelievers would achieve victory. Because this is the system of life. You see, sometimes unbelievers can achieve victory, but their victory can never be eternal. It will be partial. It will be for a very short time because Allah has taken the responsibility to give victory to those who believe in Him. And that's why I would like to assure all our Muslim brothers and sisters and friends all over the world that the present-day calamity in Palestine, the present-day calamity in Iraq, the present-day calamity in Afghanistan, the present-day calamity in other parts of the world is only a temporary event that will turn back with a great victory for Islam and for Muslims, inshallah ta'ala, because this is the promise of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى قَدْ زَوَى لِيَ الْأَرْضَ مِنْ أَطْرَافِهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown me the earth from all its peripheries. فَمَا رَأَيْتُ بَيْتَ حَجَرٍ وَلَا مَدَرٍ وَلَا وَبَرٍ إِلَّا وَقَدْ دَخَلَهُ الْإِسْلَامِ بِعِزِّ عَزِيزٍ أَوْ بِذُلِّ ذَلِيلٍ. I've not seen a single home, whether built of stone or of mud or of tents, without Islam being reaching that home. And this will be achieved either by the victory of victorious believers or by the defeat of non-victorious unbelievers. بِعِزِّ عَزِيزٍ أَوْ بِذُلِّ ذَلِيلٍ. And that's why we wait for that moment, inshallah ta'ala. We have to work hard for it, because we have got the promise from Allah, and Allah, if He promises, He fulfills His promises, because He is the supreme Lord of this universe, and His words have to come true. And inshallah, in another episode, we will touch upon other prophecies of the Holy Quran and other scientific facts revealed in that book that came down 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet within an unlettered community, and for it to contain such prophecies and such scientific facts is a living testimony that this cannot be the work of man. It is the word of the Creator, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in its divine purity and in its divine language. And I hope that we can meet again, inshallah ta'ala, in another episode of this wonderful program, Reason. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, mercy, and blessings be with you all. Thank you.